This video is about a softball team which started in Armonk, New York in 1959. The name of the team was the Armonk Waljoes. What exactly is a Waljoe anyway? Back in 1959, Walter Sentiment of Valhalla and Joe Petrie of Armonk had a construction company called Waljoe Builders, and they decided to sponsor a slow pitch softball team made up mostly of the local town baseball team members. Back in the 50s, every town had a baseball team and they would compete against other towns that belonged to the Westchester County Baseball Association League. They played every Sunday in doubleheaders, and Armonk's contingent was sponsored by the American Legion Post 1097, but I'll get back to that league later. You may be wondering, why would anyone bother to honor a team this many years later? The reason, which I will try to illustrate during this video, is that the Armonk Waljoes, in their first year of existence in 1959, and the team it morphed into several years later in 1962, Stutz Garage, can easily lay claim to the best slow pitch softball team in New York State history. Not only that, by winning 11 New York State softball championships in a row, it can also boast that it is one of the most successful teams ever assembled anywhere. Yet most folks in Armonk have never heard of them. My goal is to shed some light on their accomplishments and to honor and highlight a few of those players that made it all happen. Although Waljoes never won a national championship, they did compete in that tournament almost every year during that stretch, and they came in fifth in the world on two occasions. Take a glance at this list of New York State softball champions over the years and note that Waljoes Stutz won every year from 1959 through 1969, opting not to defend their title in 1970. This is a feat that no other team in USA history has ever done, according to several sources I contacted, including the president of the American Softball Association, as well as the office headquarters of the United States Slow Pitch Softball Association. Getting back to the original Waljoes team, who exactly were these guys who were the first team in national tournament history to appear in shorts, and who were so successful that first year? After winning the state championship, they traveled to Cleveland and came in fifth in the world, beating teams like the Kentucky State Champs and Cuba. Joe Petrie, co-owner of Waljoe Builders, founder of the team, manager, and part-time catcher with power. Everyone in Armonk knew Joe, a real good guy. Tony Palmachuk, another longtime Armonk-friendly guy who everyone liked and who filled in as pitcher when Bob Ferris needed a break. Elwood Clark, my dad, was the team's first baseman, and he will be alluded to later on in this video. Bimmy Cox, left fielder and formidable leadoff batter. More about Bimmy later. Jim Ross, utility player and proprietor of Hickory and Tweed on Main Street. Everyone in town knew Jim. Harold Lape, another longtime Armonk guy, legionnaire, and fireman. Harold played outfield and could hit for power, especially to the right side. George Koop, the team's best groupie, an extremely vocal cheerleader. Mr. Koop's verbal support helped the team succeed, and he was a great guy to have on your side. Mackie McKenzie, a utility infielder and Armonk youngster fresh out of high school when this picture was taken. Don Damer, another Armonk athlete and good guy known by everyone. Don played outfield. Ted Burfein was from Pleasantville and a tremendous all-around athlete. More about Ted later. Harry Stutz from Valhalla, owner of Stutz Garage, a great baseball player and an integral part of the team. More on Harry later on in this video. Danny Tompkins Sr., third baseman and a nicer person you'll never meet. More to follow on Danny. Bob Ferris, pitcher and a huge part of the team's success. More later regarding Mr. Ferris. Joe Goodwin was from White Plains and played right field. Very good athlete who stayed with the team when they moved on to become Stutz Garage. Charlie Condary, another great guy and fierce competitor from Pleasantville. Mr. Condary went on to become a longtime, highly respected educator and coach in the Byram Hills school system. Jim Passabit, shortstop, awesome player, and a huge part of the team, to be discussed later as well. In order to understand how dominant this team was over the years, it is important to understand how it was formed, as well as how they became so good their first year in existence. They didn't just put together an all-star team from the local Armonk Softball League, which had been in existence only for a few years at the time. They recruited from the Westchester Baseball Association's Legion Ball players, mostly from the Armonk team, but also a few others from throughout the county, including Harry Stutz from Valhalla. To understand Waljo's formation, you need to also know how incredibly good the Armonk Legion post-1097 baseball team was. Back in the 50s, growing up as a little kid in Armonk, Sundays for me meant Legion baseball doubleheaders. Not many folks remember this, but Wampus Field, aka Hunter Field, was the scene of some very high caliber hardball played by hard-nosed old school baseball players, many of which were former Collegian stars or pro or semi-pro players. The main core of Waljo's were from this team and among the best ball players in Westchester. Sundays meant going down to the field 2 hours before game time to help my dad rake, line, and prep the fields for play. Of course, he would pick up extra help along the way by enticing kids playing outside along Wampus Avenue to assist with the field prep by bribing them with 10-cent Cokes and Clark bars. It meant Jeannie Tompkins and Marge Stevenson manning the concession stand and selling 20-cent hot dogs cooked on an electric grill with Crisco and 10-cent Kisco beverage sodas. It meant passing the hat in the stands between games of the doubleheader to collect funds for bats and balls and to help pay for the umpire. And for us kids, it also meant a day of playing on the playground, retrieving foul balls that had gone into the woods, playing our own games on the small field, and just hanging out watching the grown-ups play baseball. A few of these Legion ball players that also went on to become Waljo's are worthy of special attention. Bob Ferris was a terrific all-around athlete and played in the Yankee organization. He was a great pitcher, a fantastic hitter, and was fiercely competitive. At 160 to 170 pounds, he was one of the most gifted pitchers in the county. He took the same competitiveness to the softball diamond. As a slow pitch pitcher, he would consistently toss the ball to the batter's back shoulder, and by the time the ball was in play, Bob would have backed up all the way to second base, making him a fifth infielder. Mr. Ferris was the star pitcher for the full duration of the Armonk Legion baseball team, then on to Waljo's, and then the Stutz years. Jim Passabit was the team's stellar shortstop, a virtual vacuum at his position, and a consistently reliable hitter. An Iona College standout, he was a class act on and off the field. Mr. Passabit was a lifelong friend to the Clark family, who sadly just recently passed away. I thank him for his invaluable contributions to this video, and I feel badly he never had the chance to see it. Jim also made the transition from Legion Baseball to Waljo's to Stutz Garage. Ted Burfing, outfielder, another multi-sport Iona College player, and an all-around great athlete. Ted hit for power and played defensive outfield like no other. He knew only one way to play, and that was hard-nosed baseball, and he did it exceptionally well. Ted was another Legion Baseball Waljo's Stutz mainstay. I want to thank Ted also for his many contributions to this video. Danny Tompkins, Armonk's outstanding third baseman and just an all-around good person on and off the field. Mr. T had excellent defensive skills and hit for power. He hit a home run in Ossining one Sunday afternoon that is still talked about to this day. What a great guy Danny was. Not only did his wife and daughter help run the concession stand, his son, Danny Jr., was the team's best bat boy, as he often reminds me today, and I came in a distant second. Howard Bimmy Cox, maybe the best leadoff player in New York State's low-pitch softball history. A terrific athlete and faster than just about anyone on the base paths. If he hit a grounder to the third baseman, in most cases, Bimmy would be touching first by the time the third baseman threw the ball. He was just that fast. He was also a very smart ball player, and I've never seen anyone come close to his talents of taking an extra base or confounding the opposition. He was also beloved by everyone in Armonk who knew him. Bimmy also did the Legion Baseball, Wall Joe's, Stutz trifecta. Harry Stutz, an absolute bulldog of an athlete. What Harry lacked in height, he more than made up for in strength and competitive determination. I remember watching Harry as a kid and always marveled how someone of his stature could hit the ball over the trees at Wampus Field some 350 to 400 feet away. When Joe Petri and his partner decided to stop sponsoring the team after the 1961 season, and with three New York State championships under their belt, Harry Stutz took over the sponsorship, keeping the main core of the team intact, and then recruited other players from Down County, including Portchester, Mount Vernon, and Scarsdale. From 1962 through 1969, the team was known as Stutz Garage, and they didn't miss a beat by winning another eight championships in a row and coming in fifth in the world on one more occasion at the World Tournament. Elwood Clark, my dad, was a mainstay at first base. He hit for power and high average and won the Westchester batting title several times. In the late 40s, he played with the legendary House of David team, which was easily the best barnstorming team in U.S. history. During that time, he played against such future Major League players as Willie Mays, Jimmy Fox, Luke Easter, and Jim Pearsall. I was lucky enough to play with my dad later on with the North Castle Estates for 12 years in the Armonk Softball League. Also playing on that team were Jim Passabit, Jimmy Cox, Bob Ferris, and Ted Burfein. Elwood was everyone's gym teacher that grew up in Armonk, and he served as recreation director for years, started the Armonk Little League program with others, and even co-owned Kensco Sports in Valhalla for a number of years. Playing with Wall Joes and Stutz over that 11-year stretch meant traveling by bus to many local, state, and national tournaments. It meant staying at cheap hotels and passing the time by playing cards between games and during rain delays. In many cases, the wives also travel with the team to tournaments. The following photos were extracted from slides sent to me by Ted Burfein and Jim Passabit, and they illustrate a sense of what this great team experienced over the years, and what glorious years they were. I hope you enjoy these slides, and thanks for taking the journey back in time with me. I'll see you in my next video.